like stuck in the ground.
Okay, I'm going to call this meeting to order at 6:03. Thank you very much for everyone attending. And the first order of business is to review and approve the minutes of May 10th. Could I have a motion, please?
I'm going to make a motion with a request for a deletion of one sentence.
Okay, so can we make a motion and second it, and then I got a motion. Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay, go ahead, Phil.
There was a sentence in there discussing the vote, the failed vote to go into executive session. Mm-hmm. That was like an editorial comment afterwards. Something about the people that voted the not to go into executive session trusted the administration. I'm not reading.
I think the word is had faith.
Had faith. Yeah. So the people questioning had faith too. So I would like to just move to strike that had faith part of that sentence and accept the rest of the minutes. Simply asking a question does not indicate a lack of faith. I hope.
I have to agree with you. Oh, okay. I couldn't even remember what the executive session was about.
You didn't like my had faith?
Yeah, I don't know.
If anyone is not
want to strike that,
I have faith.
Okay. Oh, yes, so vote on that. No opposition. Okay, so we're going to remove that sentence. Anything else from anyone? I liked it that Lynn spoke about Spiffy.
Spiffy?
Spiffy. It was Spiffy. Okay, all those in favor accepting the slightly altered notes or changed?
Aye.
You want to oppose?
Do
you have to
abstain?
One abstention. All righty. Moving along.
801.
Financial statements, and I do not see Patricia, so I'm going to
assume. Patty Kavanaugh is not here tonight. I do have your monthly expenditure reports to take a look at. We have 26 warrants totaling $1,829,902.86. Later on in the agenda, Darius and I are going to talk about potential end-of-year funds and ideas for how those might be expended depending upon what the total is. But you are definitely on track. One thing that has been trending throughout all of the schools is we have noticed a fairly significant savings in heat, plowing, all of those things associated with a mild winter. So that is helping all of our budgets.
Now, any questions, Bob?
Yeah, question I have. The financial statement that's here, it covers the warrants, I believe, through 531.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the warrants for this evening, they're not included, are they?
No.
Okay, so, all right. That's what I thought that was the story, so. And these are...
What was the total of that warrant again?
$1,000,002 something, wasn't it?
$1,829,902.86.
I don't know.
There's 26 warrants. That's in the signature page that's coming around.
My only concern is how much money is going to be left, but you're going to give us a report later. So.
You know why we're so over on transportation?
Is that special ed or regular?
I guess it's ex-sped.
You want to tell me where you're looking?
Page 5.
Yep. We did have two students who moved in to town that we were not able to access the bus, the big bus, and had to add an additional van. I'm going to suppose that some of those costs are associated with that.
Anyone else?
HVAC repair, $15,000 HVAC repairs to this building?
Oh, that's so typical.
I think we had a conversation about that HVAC stuff though for quite a while.
Anything else?
Hot water? You should head down to fix that.
Yeah.
At noon today after you left.
So they're going to fix it and tie it to the boiler, or is it going to be a separate system?
They're going to fix that three-way valve that we saw, I'm sure, last year.
Did we not encumber the money to do that last year?
What's that?
That was part of the money we encumbered, wasn't it?
It just got on the list last year, that's all.
Yeah, but it should have been encumbered.
Yeah, but don't forget, they're doing the building in sections. So just because you encumber a chunk of money just means that that particular section is done, and then we have to move on to another section, and which is why Jamrock's been here, employed here on a very regular basis.
Right, the AC, the AC failed in the life skills wing,
right.
So they were in to repair that, and all the other, I know that is one of the bigger projects they ran, but they've been in tinkering with throughout. So that's two different, is there a different question? So the three-way is off that money. I have a handout to show you.
Okay, because I thought we put money aside for that last last year.
Right, I was not saying that. I was, my editorial that, you know, they're working on that was not connected to DAC.
Okay.
It's hot water boiler heaters, not AC.
Because they were talking about one time possibly putting in some sort of an electric or a different standalone boiler or something for hot water.
It's on my list.
Okay.
Okay. Moving along, public comment? None. Student Advisory Council? None. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to skip over the central office update, and we're going to go down to new business and invite Mr. Scanlon to give us a review of FY15. Thank you, sir. You're on.
I'm here.
You can do any. You can sit anywhere you want.
Bring a chair up if you want.
You can stand. You can sit.
We were sounding a little stereo. Tell me which book to pick first.
Yeah, we're going to go for all three of them. And I realize I stand between you and Summer, so.
You're chewing gum during your press. You know, we get detention for that.
Got a lot of detention. I've been here 30 years.
Sorry, I couldn't. Sorry. I don't know.
For those who don't know me, I'm Tom Scanlon Jr. I'm the managing partner of Scanlon Associates. We specialize in municipal audits, school districts, cities and towns, so it's kind of our specialty. This is our first year with the district. Some general notes, the audit went very well. Your financial reporting is excellent. What I mean by that, the transaction comes into the system, it's properly accounted for. I know as governance of the district, you know, I would like to hear that. So I think that's a good note to go over. Your first report, the thicker one, that's your financials. Going to touch base on that. I know we're late in the year, I know it's June, you know, it's close to fiscal year 16. I just want to highlight some of your financial highlights in it. The reason for an audit, I know it's an expectation gap there. Some people think an audit has to do solely with fraud. That's not the sole purpose of it. It's really to opine on your financial statements. So bond rating agencies can use it, use your financial data, independent source looking at it. Granting agencies will also get a copy of reports, so if you have a qualified opinion, let's say you might be dinged and you may not qualify for a grant, or you may bump the bond market and you have a qualified opinion and a lesser rating and a higher interest rate. The district did receive an unmodified opinion, which is the best opinion you can get. So that's on pages 3 and 4. So that's kind of the sole purpose. That's what bond companies are looking for. That's what granting agencies. It's as we design our audit procedures, we look at your financial statements, really a risk assessment approach. We do a lot of analytical assessment on comparing last year, this year, compare budgets to actuals. We don't see a variance, like a negative question. We'll probably dive into that, say, was there a mischarge of expenditures? That's how we kind of approach the audit. Off your balance sheet, we're really looking at your cash and receivables as your two number one assets. This year, cash is being balanced. Dive into the bank reconciliations, making sure proper documents there for outstanding checks. Found no issues with them. So go to pages 12 and 13. The weird thing about municipals, about governments, there's actually two sets of balance sheets that a district can have. And these first two, 12 and 13, those are your full accrual statements. See on there, they recognize depreciation. You don't have depreciation in your budget. on here is your liability for OPEB, and I'm sure you've heard OPEB around and around and around. It's other post-employment benefits. It's really your promise that you made to your employees that you're going to pay X amount of their health insurance when they retire. That's reflected on these financial statements. Things that will jump out at you on these, and I call these accountants dreamland. They really serve no purpose, these first two, except for accountants. If you look at your net position, and you'll see unrestricted, what jumps out at you is a negative 7.7 million. And there's three factors that are driving that. You really don't want to see your net position in negative. And it's your OPEB, which is about 5.3 million. That's on your balance sheet. I believe your liability really isn't 5.3 million, but it's not zero either. But this is the best way we can assess it and come up with calculations. You have an OPEB study done by an actuary. It's a lot of assumptions made in there. I know the district opened up an OPEB trust this year in fiscal year 15. You contributed $100,000 to it. The thing with OPEB thinking is really long-term thinking. You're not going to solve a $5.3 million liability in your balance sheet overnight. It's next step for, I would say, for the district is to develop a plan for it. Are you going to build the OPEB trust up to, say, $10 million? And then after you hit $10 million, anyone that retires after that will be paid out of that trust. So virtually, you start funding the trust and all your retirees over time will eventually pay it out of the trust. So that's really how you have to think of OPEB. It's really long-term thinking. Does anyone have any questions?
That was a little bit fast for me, but I was trying to follow along.
It's really, you're putting $100,000 on it. I don't know what the goal is, to do $100,000 a year or some aspect of it, how much you're gonna, funding you're going to do to it. You have to come up with some sort of plan, hit the $2 million mark, $3 million mark. When are you going to start utilizing the trust to pay for retirement health costs?
Well, I was just, I can't get past the part where you said our liability's not as much as we thought it was. I got really happy when you said that.
Well, I just don't
couldn't get past the rest of it.
Yeah, but there's a lot of assumptions in that. You know, there's healthcare trends, there's life expectancy tables in there. I just don't believe it's 5.3 million. It's not zero either, somewhere in between. But for accounting purposes, 5.3 million. Your next liability on there is your net pension liability. That's being funded, it's through Franklin County Retirement. That's always been there. This is the first year it's gone on your balance sheet. And that's at 2.1 million. So those two together are really driving that unrestricted deficit. Tony, look, don't get too excited about it. I mean, you're not alone amongst those school districts and municipalities. I think what you're doing by adopting an OPEB trust, that's one way to combat it, but really just, I can't stress enough, develop a plan for it. Just don't keep on putting money into it. Look to utilize it at some point in the future. Those are the first two statements. On pages 14 and 15, these are more your traditional statements on a cash basis of accounting. You'll see some similar numbers. You both have cash, both the same number, both balance sheets. That's what's unique about a government. This is where your E&D is certified from. You see under unassigned fund balance in a general fund, that's the basis of your E&D. You'll see unassigned is 366, and I believe your E&D was 458. The difference being the current share of compensated absences, the state will add that back to your E&D because they don't count that as a current expense. So when you look at the balance sheet, look at what that difference is. That is the difference. The non-major funds, you'll see it broken out on page 48. They're basically your grants, your revolving funds, your circuit breaker. That's what makes up the non-major funds. As we look, as far as from an audit approach, if we test on here, your balance sheet, we're really looking at the cash, as I said before. We're looking at your receivables. Again, it's a risk-based approach. If we saw a lot of deficit accounts here that are driving something that receipts aren't coming in necessarily or expenses are mischarged, you don't have that on your balance sheet, which is a good thing. Coming from a district that had a deficit balance of $382,000, as we got into it, it discovered that was a fraud on their balance sheet. The person had stole $400,000. You don't have that on your balance sheet. And one of the factors in there is the school committee was not reviewing the financial statements and looking for deficit accounts. So as a saw you reviewing that statement, actually. I think it felt pretty good. Actually, that is a control procedure in place. But you don't have any of that on your balance sheets. And then the last statement I just want to talk about is on page 18. This is really your budget versus actual. This is the basis of where your E&D is being driven from. Your last 2 years, your E&D has been virtually the same, but you're under the 5%, which is good. You want to be as close to that 5% as you can going over. If you look on your revenue side, what contributes your E&D is $91,000. The big you contribute to that is under intergovernmental $67,000, which is Medicaid. You're not budgeting for the Medicaid, which is some fiscal budgeting. We'll want to budget for a Medicaid amount, which in turn reduces your assessments to the towns. But Medicaid is very fluctuant, and you might never will range your E&D, which is good. And then you'll see on the expenditure side, you're turning back about $54,000, which is pretty good on a $10 million budget. Get right there with your expenditures. So you use about $140,000 of E&D, $100,000 out to the OPEB trust, and $40,000 to a transportation revolving. And then you generate $145,000. So your use of E&D and how you're generating it is sound. That's what the statement is telling you. With school districts, their two chief revenue sources are assessments to towns and intergovernmental revenues. So every time you want to make a financial decision, it's really affecting the towns or it's affecting the state aid. Keeping that in mind as you generate, someone's going to have the reserves. Either the town's going to have the reserves or the district's going to have the reserves when you get out there in the bonding market, if you ever get out there and issue bonds. Your E&D, I like where it is, you're just under that 5%. Something you might want to start considering is maybe establishing a stabilization fund, getting up maybe 2 or 3% of your budget. Some school districts are doing that. And they're also adopting a compensated absences reserve.
Did you say that again?
Compensated absences reserve. So when someone leaves, you buy back part of their sick time. Just another form of reserve. The law passed in 2011 allowed districts and towns to establish that. Something the district might think about considering in the future. That's kind of the general financial highlights in a nutshell. If you have some questions, you see a lot of perplexed faces. Your financial statements are really boring, which is a good thing. You want to see.
Questions?
I guess I'd just like to say with regards to OPEB, I'm not sure that we have a plan. I think that it was great to start with what we have, and I think we're all learning from it.
No, we had decided to establish the fund, and that was like year one, and then year two was to put some money into it. Okay. But we did not have a plan going forward as to how much, and I think that's, you know, a very good thing to keep talking about in the future.
Yeah, I'm across the school district in that same shape of town. Yeah. It's start off and get this liability in your balance sheet, and everyone said, oh my God, how big is the balance? It's growing. That isn't growing across all municipalities. And kind of the second step was the monitoring companies, everyone, local ranking agencies. What are you doing about it? Well, the restructured health insurance plan, they worked out where they could cut. And then the third step is now funding. And you want to be budget funding, don't have trust. Once you get material amount in there, which you're far away from, get that goal and then have that, say, okay, I'm going to start charging the trust. I know the big misconception about the trust is a lot of people think they're non-expendable, and they are expendable, they're just not irrevocable. So you can charge expenditures to the trust, but it has to be for health insurance and retirees.
If I heard you correctly, the real first step for us in that regard would be to get an actuarial
study
to find out what's
already happened.
Yeah, we've had that.
That's
where
the $5.3 million is coming from.
But that number you're not confident in.
I'm confident from an accounting standpoint.
Right, but but that's not a real number. We want to know what a real number is.
I guess it's all forecast. A real number for accounting wise. I mean, I'm not too sure. I get a lot of people that extinguished here in the next year. Liability changes quite a bit. So there's life expectancy tables factored in. There's discount rates factored in. I think right now, I think he used 4.25 discount rate. You can play with that, and the numbers are going to change.
Well, you brought up an important point that if we got into a squeeze, we could use it to fund the retirement contributions and what have you when, in a particular year if we got into a squeeze.
Yep.
Which I don't think we quite understood that before.
No, that's a big misconception. People think it's not spendable, but it's not. You just would charge. If you did get into a squeeze, you could charge. It has to be retirees' health insurance.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, we got into a squeeze, we could use it.
Absolutely.
And, well, we couldn't use it for light bulbs.
That's not
my thing. I mean, it'd have to be just
they
for
need
the
to
retirement.
See. What? Those retirees need to see.
That's true.
I know, but they're not going to be here to see.
That took me a while.
Because
that,
we're
that
all
was almost
blind,
over.
Blind, can't hear.
Tell me,
lighten it up.
How many school committees have an audit committee to review the warrants?
I would say starting to get there.
How do they find people for such stupefyingly boring duty?
They usually stop me. It's usually like 3 members of the committee will come in and sign the warrants.
When you guys finish your building committee stuff, there you go.
We're primed for stupefying board. You're right.
I know Marmar just switched. I believe they went to a 3-member home.
I think you put the 3 lowest members.
I would say 4 to 5 home are switching based on our recommendation.
Sorry.
But in the,
you probably
were, in your experience, where you found incidents where there might be possible embezzlement, was there an audit committee that actually looked at this stuff?
I'm going to say no.
Okay, that's right. My point.
No, but if there was, then
you
it's kind of useless
caught.
To have it.
That's
still
my
happened.
Point. Yeah, and you know, I think we should be doing it.
Well, that was your recommendation in your management audit. You had 4 key
right
recommendations,
right,
and I thought that was one of the very concrete, something that we could probably establish pretty quickly.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, we need school districts, a lot of them are going down, it's not a problem.
Now, is the bond that the treasurer has, is that sufficient to protect us? And are we sufficiently protected with our funds that are invested in the various banks? If a bank failed, are we covered up to the amount of the whole thing?
Treasurer's bond, that's right up to the limit you're covered there. And then you also have a blanket bond that covers other employees too.
Yep.
That's sufficient. Your investment risk, your custodial credit risk. Yeah, you have no exposure, custodial credit risk. Your bank deposits at June 30, $2.1 million. I'll cover you by DIA.
Okay. That's all I want to make sure. I have no more questions.
Specific questions or anything? Or I know the plan for this year, I think we're going to come at the end of August. Probably finish up audit field work. Federal grants are changing, and they do up. October 31st, so I won't have a final product until my first part of December. That's kind of our audit plan this year. We did a lot of groundwork for next year. We're going to look at your collection process of your house outlier receipts, like your athletic revolving fees, sped revolving, say, revenues you're collecting outside, kind of your outlier secondary revenues. This year we kind of focused on your primary revenues, but in your bank account, so get out there. If you ever have any concerns, don't state, call the office in the area. A lot of the feedback we get from committees helps us out. It's a lot of what we want to focus. We're looking at your balance sheet, we do a lot of analytical, we're going to do our testing. So feedback helps us become key in our thinking.
The only thing I'd like to add is I just thought your group was very professional, very efficient. I did.
I
know you weren't, Tom. Maybe that's why. No. But it was very nice having, you know, a new audit firm for the first time. You're never sure what it, but it was a very pleasant experience for everybody.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you. There are no more questions. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom.
Thanks.
More than welcome to stay for the rest of our exciting meeting.
I got two
yeah, there you go.
Mm-hmm. Probably right now I'm trying to fire up that stove.
Well, thank you very much.
Take it easy, Tom.
Okay, so we're going to go backwards and do the central office update now.
Yeah, before I turn it over to Phil, I would just like to say the committee of Bob, and Phil, we have met religiously at least every 4 or 5 days, it seems like, since we've met. We've had 5 or 6 meetings since our last school committee meeting. We've gathered a lot of information, but we have a ways to go. So with that, I will turn it over to the chair of the Building Study Committee, Phil Cantor.
There's a lot of moving parts to this search. So what we anticipate being able to do is to come with an actual price tag for each of for several options, along with a recommendation. But to actually get firm numbers on the options, it takes a lot of work, and we're not there yet. And it's not for anybody's lack of diligence. It's without going into all the histrionics, we need more time, and we're going to need a summer Frontier Regional School Committee meeting.
So we're exploring two things. We're exploring entering into an agreement with the Whately Town Hall. We just received what I passed out to you this afternoon. Okay, so this is hot off the press. And we are exploring Frontier Regional as an option. What our committee is looking for is endorsement, support from you to continue going forward, because right now we don't know what the actual cost of having a designer come in and do renovations and partitions in the Whately Town Hall. We do not know what the cost would be if we were to move into Frontier as far as having an adult bathroom.
Don't say Town Hall, you're going to scare people in Whately.
Why? I'm sorry, what's it?
Town Hall is still the building in the center.
Oh,
town.
I'm sorry.
If somebody was watching us on TV, they're moving into the Town Hall.
Okay, what is it called?
Town offices.
The town offices. The new Whately Town offices, the former library.
Sandy Lane.
Sandy Lane. Thank you. Sorry. Thank you for telling me that.
Yeah, go crazy.
So those are the two options. Both are not without cost. I will also say that the bookkeeper's busiest time for our office, those four people who work really hard, is during the summer. So they were looking for something towards fall anyway. So this is the first proposal that we've gotten from Whately. And it's a negotiation. It doesn't mean that this is something we would accept. And we also, the committee had a chance to walk through the space sort of designated potentially here at Frontier to see how that might work. Again, you have to be very careful of closing off access from the public to the students, and there would be cost association with that. So what I would recommend is that you give this committee and Lynn Carey, your new superintendent, permission to keep going forward and actually gathering real financial numbers so that they can present something to you. What we do know is that currently we did a 3-year analysis of the costs of staying at the current facility, and it's about $26,000 a year in utilities and just general maintenance. So we were looking at a rental agreement, if that was comparable. And as you know, Bob Lesko has brought you a breakdown of what it would cost to bring the current Whately superintendent's office up to snuff. And that was minimum of $200,000, but more likely $500,000.
And they could all use firming up and real vendors with real numbers behind each of those estimates would is what we want to be able to do. And I mean, you can see looking from what she handed out from the Sandy Lane proposal, you can't even look at that and really say what that would cost. There's still, even in that proposal, there's vagaries and you know, head scratching kind of what is it going to be kind of a thing. And so that's what.
But I think you bring us enough information that, you know, it begs to say, yes, we need more. So I do agree that this team should be given the go-ahead to continue and negotiate.
Is that a motion?
That is a motion. I make a motion that the team be allowed to continue and negotiate further.
Second.
All those, any further discussion? All those in favor? Meeting in the summer, what are you thinking?
I think you're going to need at least 6 to 7 more weeks of.
So are we talking August?
Yeah.
Okay. No, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
So kind of.
So you're going to do the second Tuesday in August?
Do I want to do that, or
does
do
anyone
need to
want
do that?
To?
No.
We don't want to, but why don't you just keep in touch?
You're going away?
No.
No.
Just keep in touch.
He doesn't want to do it at all.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, it is summer.
This is a really important thing. This
exactly.
This is big, big decision. Once central office moves, even if it's 5-year leases with endless renewals,
right.
It's really hard to move again quickly.
Yeah.
The expense and aggravation of moving is a huge issue. It's like once they move, they're there for
a
while.
So you're thinking another 6 weeks and you'll have something else?
Yeah.
I think vendors are more likely to give us some real numbers if we have support, you know, to acquire that information.
I think once we figure out what's going on with the high school, I think Bob Lesko can give us some numbers on there. Again, it's we have a map. Darius took us through the school tonight. We saw what could be available. Mm-hmm. You know, is it pretty? It's not pretty, but at least we're looking at it, and we want to get some serious numbers there. Mm-hmm. And then we have a contact, I think Bob has a contact that Marty has, so we can get maybe a vendor next week to come up. And, you know, John Robleski from Waitley's been really good with doing a schematic on a smart board for us a couple different times. You know, the size of the cubicles, whose office is here, whose office is there. And it looks pretty good, you know, on a smart board, but actually laying it out is two different things, but I think we can utilize the roughly 25,000 square feet of space.
2,500.
Excuse me.
So nice.
We could. We really could use 3,000, but 2,500. We're that's what we're going off right now on the cubicles and the offices.
But Lexington is the name of the company that provides cubicles and that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's my understanding they will come for no cost.
Mm-hmm.
We show them what the layout is, and they'll come up with some sort of a schematic on it. And you can buy it from them, whatever we need. We can buy it through the Massachusetts Educational Consortium, which we're a member of, and they're already filed bids so that we can take care of our issues.
Okay.
Yep.
And,
you know, they also have used equipment. And we can bid it for used stuff too.
Right.
And they will want to understand structure a financing deal where we can pay them so much a year.
Okay. Well, and thank you very much for doing this. Really, all kidding aside, this is a huge, huge undertaking, and I know all of us appreciate that you're doing this. So all you have to do is let us know when, and we'll schedule what's good for everybody. Maybe send out something with some dates on it. Pick a date and see.
Yeah, we did a lot. I interviewed every single person in the central office.
Is this Union Regional?
It have to be, wouldn't it?
Is it joint? Well, right now we own the building.
Yeah, we own
the building.
I understand that, but a central office move, you wouldn't involve the local committees in a central office move?
You know, that's a really good question, and we hadn't talked about that, but I think we should. You're right.
I just assumed so. Maybe I'm wrong.
I actually thought that we had this conversation, and
because they contributed a good share of their budget.
Sure,
I missed that question.
I was asking if this particular next conversation has to take place between Union Regional, I mean everybody.
Joint committee.
The way I read the lease agreement was that this committee owns the building.
Oh, I get that.
Okay.
So do we want to, when we move, if we move, do we want to...
The union owns a good share of your budget. More than half.
Mm-hmm. Postpone it until the...
Okay. I'm not trying to...
No, we can have a joint meeting and all.
Are they... They're not picking up any of these costs. Is the union picking up, the superintendency union picking up any of the cost for the electricity or anything at central office?
It's proportioned out the way it always is, based on your percentage. Each year, your percentage has changed.
I thought that was one of the things Patty did in the budget this year, is to apportion out everything.
Everything
where it belongs.
Correct.
To each individual town. So I think you've got five stakeholders in this decision and not one.
Well, don't make it too encumbering, too many people.
Well,
but they probably should be included.
But they should be included. Because if we move, we can change everything to include everybody. So do your thing and get in touch with us.
Okay.
And then we can have that conversation with the new superintendent and see what's best for everybody. Okay?
Madam Chairperson.
Yes.
As we move on, I know it's out of time in the public, whatever, but we have a member of the public. She was given the wrong time to come here, but... I move that we allow her to speak out of turn, the MTA Save Our Schools representative, because what she has to say is interesting and I support it very much.
Well, I'm going to put that to when I don't even have to.
And I don't think she'll take that long.
Diane will be quick, and let me just give you some background. Diane Jensen Oshevsky is a former teacher, a long-term sub in our district. And as you know, I've been concerned about the lifting of the charter cap for a long time. This is a grassroots organization. She has come to each of the school committees. The Whately School Committee directed me months ago to write a letter to Representative Kulik and Senator Rosenberg to voice their opinion that they were not supportive of the lifting of the cap. So Diane has come. I have folders of information I was going to at least pass out to you. And representatives like her are going everywhere throughout the state to talk briefly about it. And I know our agenda's packed, but if you could be brief, is that all right?
I promise. Hi, I'm Diane Jensen-Oshevsky. I taught in Chicopee for 35 years. I retired 3 years ago, sophomore year. And I work part-time for Mass Teachers Association as a state district coordinator, so my job is to work on issues that affect education. And this, at our annual meeting, was described as the existential threat to public education. If the cap on charter schools gets lifted, that means 12 more schools a year, and the way the ballot initiative is written, that's written into perpetuity. So we all know what it's like now. If the cap is lifted, it will also be lifted to go to areas that aren't level four schools. So that means it can come to any suburban or preferred district like our district. We are now losing $408 million a year to charter schools with little or no accountability in most cases. They have corporate-like boards. Over 60% of them don't have a parent on the board. Many of the people on the boards are not educators and have never been educators. We have had great difficulty getting records. There's a letter in the packet that I gave you that our state auditor, Suzanne Bump, wrote to the Joint Committee on Education in January, I think it was, expressing her deep concern about where the taxpayers' dollars were going, because the data that's being given to the state from charters is inadequate, poorly collected, and not giving us enough data to establish how they're performing, even though they're always claiming to be better than the public schools. The other key civil rights issue here is that the public schools take everyone. We take all the kids with special needs, starting at age 3, which was the job I did. I worked in the integrated preschool. And we don't get to pick and choose what grades we're enrolling kids. We also take all the English language learners. And we know for a fact that the charters are not enrolling or keeping kids that are ELL, English language learners, or special needs students. They're being serviced very disproportionately. Their lottery systems don't have any transparency, so we're not really sure how they get the families that they get, or, you know, if that's really a legitimate lottery system. But the bottom line is that if we don't work together to talk to other citizens in the Commonwealth, and that's everyone, whether your kids are in public school or not, because it's taxpayers' dollars that we don't know where they're going. And the more that gets taken out of our system, the harder it is for school committees to, you know, keep the programs and staff that they want to keep. And I mean, I just read an article about where I taught yesterday in the paper. Chickabee's, you know, struggling to not lay off teachers. So if you can look at the packet, it's got great talking points. Massteacher.org also has great talking points. If anyone can go on that site and click on Issues in Action, and you can get any kind of information. We're going to have a table at the farmers market in Greenfield all summer on Saturday morning, and we're trying to do other things like that so that we're out spreading the word, because a lot of people don't really understand this issue, and we're not framing it as a we hate charter schools issue. We're just saying if we lift the cap, it is going to be the beginning of the end of public education as we know it in the Commonwealth. And that's happened in other places. Los Angeles is an example. New Orleans is completely charterized now, and it is a bad situation. So I guess the thing that bothers me the most about it is that public education was created in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts by Horace Mann. It was his idea to give free, quality, accessible public education to everyone. And right now we have a system that's separate and unequal, and it's not only budget crisis, but it's a civil rights crisis, because a lot of these schools that are charters are not accessible to all kids. I know for where I taught, we had a high poverty rate. We had 75 homeless kids in front of the high school every day. So I know those kids can't access a school where their parents have to drive them and be on a cooperative or whatever. So that automatically nixes their chances to be there. So I feel passionately about it, even though it's not going to affect my job. I feel like it's going to affect our electorate. And, I mean, the goal of this is the people behind this ballot initiative are all kinds of conservative groups funded by the Walton family, the Koch brothers, Freedom Works, and on and on and on. And they're all millionaires and billionaires. They live on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. They don't live in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, but you know, if you turn on business sector shows, news shows, you'll see that they talk about the education sector now, because they have figured out that they can make money from standardized testing and charter schools. So it's big business, and they, lots of people want to invest in it because it's lucrative. So talk to your neighbors and friends. I put, I didn't give you buttons, but I'll leave some. And if anyone wants to sign a pledge card, we're going to have canvassing, door knocking, phone banking, you name it, we're doing it, because this is really a fight and we have to win. We absolutely have to win, or, you know, it just will be bad for Massachusetts. The NAACP filed a lawsuit also about it, and the MTA has filed an amicus brief with the NAACP, so it's a big deal. So anything that you need, I left my card with Marty, and
I'll take a button to wear all the time.
I'll take a button.
I mean, if you just are wearing it at the grocery store or the dump, I mean, people will say, what does that button mean? And I, Conway and Waitley, I'm going to go to Sunderland next week.
And Deerfield, you've been there.
And Deerfield. Sorry.
Deerfield.
Yeah, just watch the other mic. Throw that in TV land. Got okay, quite a shock.
Thank you. I really appreciate you letting me have a few minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Diane.
Thanks, Diane.
And I'm grateful for the public school
assistance. Are we good?
Are we good? Yay.
All right, have a great summer. All right, thank you very much. Okay, we are still on unfinished business review of non-union salary recommendations. Yes, last month I brought to you the salaries, and as we've been doing the last couple of years, our practice is to give them to you a month. If anyone has any questions or concerns, they can certainly call me or email me. I didn't hear from anybody, but regardless, I'm asking for approval of those salaries this evening.
The monies are budgeted, correct?
Correct.
And they're budgeted at the 2%.
Correct.
I make a motion that we approve it, subject to the review of the superintendent, based upon evaluations, et cetera.
I'd like to second that motion, please.
I don't really understand what based upon evaluations means.
Well, the superintendent does the evaluations. If somebody's not at an evaluation isn't favorable, I mean, she could withhold a 2% change.
I would think if they were going to be withheld, they would not be on the sheet.
I thought that's why it's okay to take his motion the way it is, because that's obviously reflected already in the thing.
Well, I would think so. I would hope so.
If they're asking for 2%, we can't say, well, you get 1.5. If the superintendent decides
we actually don't set the salaries of these people anymore since ed reform. It's the superintendent does it.
She just brings it up in front of us.
Yeah. Yeah. Are they merit raises? No, they're not.
They're COLAs.
No, there should be some merit raises,
but they're not merit.
They're COLAs, and she can give them to them whether we want her to or not.
Yeah.
Typically, in the past, I have done the exact same amount that the teachers have got. However, this year, what I did is gave them 2 because the teachers negotiated 1. But the teachers, when I'll get into that in a few minutes, did a 1, 2.5, 2.5.
Are all these people who are on this sheet evaluated in some way, shape, or form?
Yes, they are.
Let's go.
Anyone else? All those in favor? Opposed? Okay, good to go.
Thank you.
Okay, so moving on to new business, skipping A into B, policies.
Policies. So I have one more committee after this. I brought sections K and L. Because nobody has taken me up on even wanting to read these, but that's fine.
We trust you implicitly.
I know.
Yeah, some of us did.
The good news is I did have fun doing it. I had a great committee, and all of the policies, once Sunderland votes it next week on the 21st, will be online for you in August, so you can search.
Excellent.
Just by a category.
So it's online in August?
Online in August, so I am asking for approval of the last 2 sections of your policy book, sections K and L.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions or discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
If you could have talked faster on that one, you could have had that approved even faster.
I know.
So down to ratifications.
Yeah, I brought the. We just got the teachers' agreements today, which is why you're just getting them in the in your emails. I can quickly go through and highlight for you the changes. I know Judy was on the committee, and Cindy was on the committee, and Bob was on the committee, and Bill Maripis was on the committee. So feel free to chime in. The teacher contracts. I'll start with the salaries. I said it was 1, 2.5, 2.5. The other change had to do a lot of legal language cleanup, especially around family, medical, and parental leave. The big thing is the sick leave buyback. So anyone starting who's hired July 1st of this year, when they retired, they will receive $30 per day for the first 100 days and $40 a day for any remaining 60, for maximum of 160. So the maximum amount that a teacher could receive is 160 days. Currently, they get 2 days per year at their current salary rate. So this will change the maximum to $5,400. Because some of our teachers now are accruing 29 and 30,000 in sick leave buyback when they retire.
But this only affects the new hires.
It affects the new hires.
Yeah, going forward.
Yes, going forward. The other change to the contract was...
Tremendous administration and treatment.
Well, Phil says, yes, we were very pleased.
It is.
We were very pleased. And we added in...
20 years from now.
Right.
It's amazing.
And I know this will be where they will be going for the elementary in 3 years as well. We did add a CAGS and doctorate column. So those were the major changes for the teachers. Contract. I don't know if any committee members have anything they'd like to add to that.
I just have a question. Relative to the scheduling and the flexibility that the administration has, we're going to have more flexibility on how you assign your staff, correct?
He has flexibility now.
No, no, but with block scheduling and all that other stuff.
Well, they did do a side letter of agreement that the union is going to be reviewing block scheduling right. again.
Okay, that's what I want to make sure, sure that that's on track.
Yes, that was added. Under the instructional assistants, they had very few changes. Do you want to vote that first before I, what do you want to do? Do you want me to talk about both?
We can vote them separate, but let her finish talking.
Sorry. Okay. So the big change in evaluation and observation was that we had originally put March 1st that the instructional assistants needed to be evaluated, which is really too early. So we changed that to April 1st. And they had asked to be paid for the half day, the day before Thanksgiving, which we thought was reasonable because all the teachers, frankly, are getting that. And their salary increase, they went from zero the first year and then 2.5, 2.5. And what they did is they dropped the first step, which is why they went to zero. So that was it for the instructional assistants. It was a relatively quick procedure. Do you have any committee members have anything you wanted to add to that?
I thought it was probably the smoothest year union and Frontier that I've ever seen in being on negotiations. I mean, except for the teacher's contract in the union, which labored a little bit.
Yeah.
All the other ones went really smooth.
It's my understanding the teachers have ratified the contract?
Yes.
Okay. But I noticed that the contract I got in the email wasn't signed by them.
They're coming in. The timing of this was difficult, but they have voted and they have ratified this.
Okay, so we're not going to review it again.
No.
So moved.
So second? Your first and last contract, you did a hell of a job.
Thank you, Mr. Cantor.
So are you still moving for both of them
yes.
that you passed?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, all those in favor?
Who's the second first?
Me.
Bill. Okay. Opposed? Abstained? We're good.
I don't have a cafeteria report. I think if you meet in the summer, I'm going to request that Patty give you a cafeteria report. She does not have the financials for that yet. I can tell you district-wide, our participation ranges anywhere from 66% to 48%. What I really wanted to look at was participation at Frontier. One of the things that I would like the school committees to start thinking about, and I've said this to all the elementaries, is that every year at the end of the year, we have a deficit in most of the schools, and it can range from a few hundred dollars to several thousand dollars. And usually we ask school committees if we can use any of the end of the year funds to apply to that deficit. And we've already done that with three of the meetings that we've had. And it's getting to the point that I think you need to either start thinking about putting some money into your budgets to cover some salaries so that at least you can plan for these deficits. And I think next year it should be a discussion for you as to how these cafeterias should be run. The options throughout the state are never seemingly terrific. You have the government commodities have changed. You have the new health regulations. And staffing costs are expensive. I've been in systems where they've outsourced food preparation to a company. They have mixed reviews. I've been in places where they've done the cooking in central spots and trucked it to different places. That has good and bad. We have in some of the elementary schools separate committees that are working with cafeteria staff and administration to try to improve on quality and participation. I have to say there's not one school in the district that is doing, has any more than 66% participation rate. And we've tried a lot of things. So maybe we accept that that's how it is. I don't know.
But we can, if, assuming we have some money left in our budget, we could pay the vendor bills for June out of our budget instead of charging them to the revolving account, if that would be sufficient to cover whatever the deficit
it
you're talking
be.
About.
It could be.
Sending, doing the meals off thing, there's all these hard, the Sodexo Marriott is the one that's pushing all that because they have a massive facility in Springfield and they have a contract for the state's prison systems. And so they want, you know, they want to serve the schools and the prisons the same meals. And which
the file inside.
It's the same it's the same builders that build the same buildings already. Why not? But and the thing about it is that what they're constantly accused of is getting in there with a low price to a school committee, getting you to close your kitchen, fire your staff, and then jacking you up.
Right.
And then you can't do anything about it.
And I'm not making any recommendations, but I just don't want to lose it off your radar.
Right.
Okay.
So is this 66% from people who actually buy lunch?
Yes.
Do we have any kind of information on what gets thrown out? I mean, how many of these kids actually eat these lunches?
My daughter has never, going into 10th grade, has never bought
but
a,
I mean,
meal, bought a
no,
meal
no, no,
here.
But there's kids who buy these lunches and don't eat them. So, but we have no...
You know, when we were here at one time, we did an experiment where we weighed the waste, and we did that because we looked into composting. Are you laughing? That was... But that was labor intensive, and some foods weigh more than other foods, so it wasn't the best kind of experiment.
And does government food compost?
Some of it, but maybe
not.
The cheese.
So
I don't know.
It's interesting. The government regulations are interesting. So we have a senior go through, get a lunch. They'll say you need to take an apple.
Right.
The senior say I don't want an apple. Right. The senior, we can't serve you a lunch unless you put an apple on your tray.
Correct.
I'm an 18-year-old person. I don't want an apple. You have to put an apple on a tray. We can't serve you. And then I have to come over and say, just hit the apple on the tray, please. And you know, so it's that kind of situation.
But
there's
some schools that have tables set up for those apples.
We do that.
We do have
a...
Give an apple, take an apple table.
That's right.
But we do have a, you know, for packaged products and sealed fruits.
Right.
There's a table where they can do an exchange. But
it's sad you have to do that.
But it's, I'm just saying, when you really look down to the silliness of the law, I mean, I'm talking about the 18-year-old, not just the 7th grader. But,
and the poor lunch people get the blame for making them take something that they don't want.
Right.
So... What do you want to do? Do you want to pay June's, or is that going to...
Well, what I'd like to do is have a motion to, if there is an overage, which I don't know yet, of how you would like to cover that expense.
Well, you haven't paid June's bills yet, so I would think that if you had the monies available, you know, up to $5,000 or $7,000 or what, we'd probably take care of probably what your deficit is.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be that much, but...
Well, go to four.
So what does the motion have to be?
Well, where will the money then come for June's bills?
Right.
Well, it will come, assuming we have enough money to pay the regular bills, they're talking about having money left over in the budget. I'm saying that we take about 4,000 of it and pay the cafeteria vendors out of that, and so the trust fund doesn't go into deficit. That's all. It'd be better if we had all the figures. We did this years ago.
We
paid the salaries.
Do we have to vote it with a figure, or can we just vote to pay it out of June's?
You don't have to vote it with a figure.
Okay.
Motion to pay it out of June's, whatever you just said, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
I'll second the confusion of the motion.
All those in favor of being confused? No. All those in favor of paying the lunch bill out
of if there is a deficit.
If there is a deficit.
Assuming we have a surplus regular budget.
Correct.
And can I briefly just continue the conversation? At present, do we have Sodexo, or are we providing our own food?
We have our own staff.
It's
prepared in house.
He means is they like to get rid of our staff and then take over
that,
low.
That's Sodexo.
They're aggressively marketing to the area schools with really low prices.
Yeah.
They'll lowball you, and then two years later, they'll come in with a 30% increase.
Yeah. I guess I'm interested in what Marty brought up about, you know, would we want to have part of the committee, and I am volunteering myself, look at our food, and, you know, because so we can look at why our kids throwing away food. And
school councils at different schools have done that, and they've worked with local farm groups, and because the idea is not to point fingers at people, because I think people are doing the best job within the parameters that they have.
I'm not sure.
But, you know, is there another way to look at it? That's all.
Yes.
20 figures is okay, though.
Debbie never
professional chefs can do amazing things.
I'm sure they can do amazing. They can do amazing things.
No, you didn't. You just need a motion.
We sort of started to take a vote, and then we kind of stopped. So
I'm sorry. I thought we did take a vote.
For all those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Okay. Now we took the vote. That makes me feel good. Okay, discussion of track facility.
Well, this really dovetails because Darius's item is really not on the agenda, but I had included in your packet an email, and if you don't have it, I'll pass out another copy, from Bob Smith talking about the problems with the track. And as you're paying off your loan that you've had, I think it's really important for the committee to keep these very large expenditures in mind. Because you don't want to have things fall apart and become so decrepit that they're not usable. So as he points out in the memo that we've done a lot of patchwork, as best we can, a few thousand here and there, but it's getting to the point that it really needs a major overhaul. So that is not something that can be addressed in any potential end of the year funds. But I just didn't, as I'm departing, I just trying to pass on information that I think is important.
I think I asked you this before, and I probably got an answer, but I forgot what the answer was, so I'll ask you again. The lighting money. Have we gotten a definitive answer on what we can do with it?
The lighting money can be used for lighting.
Only?
Yes, because that was the original intent, and there are currently still members in the community who are on that committee.
Well, can we put lights on the track while we're fixing it?
You could put lights on a baseball field. You could put...
Just a shot.
Was the fundraising just for the football field?
No, we were told that it could be for lights, for athletic purposes. Okay. You could put them on the tennis courts. You could put them on...
And the scoreboards, I thought, too.
Scoreboards. Yes.
Yeah.
No, I just wonder if there's any way of accessing them. If we don't need lights, the money sits.
That was what my hope was.
And we've got a project like this that needs to be done.
Right.
Like we got really creative with the tennis courts, the CPA money in the towns,
right.
And the towns are really good about it. And we got it done that way. And I don't know how much money is left in the lighting thing, and I don't know how much money.
$66,000.
I don't know what this will cost, the track will cost, but.
$200,000, so. But you can put up lights. There is an account. It exists. You have $66,000.
But I think that's the only thing that's not in here is
the
problem.
Okay, we can see more of the holes.
Lights of baseball. You can go to court and get a judge.
No, I wasn't so much concerned about the lights.
We have been to court.
So that's just informational.
So, I mean, it goes to the chair, what we talked about prior to the meeting.
Correct.
Is that this committee needs to pretty, within the next, hopefully the fall, is figure out how to get a bond for this building from through the towns. What is the process? Because you don't have it in your regional agreement. Well, how do you get a bond for the town?
We do
because
have it in the regional agreement. All four towns after the school committee approves and all four towns approve.
You have a bond, you can't do a capital.
Or
a
capital expenditure,
yeah.
Sorry. So within that, so there is a lot of, and when we talk, I don't know when you want to talk about that as my part of my report, but there are a lot of, the building's getting very tired. There's a lot of projects we've been putting off, and that's kind of crept along, and one of them, you know, the track is eventually going to wear down, and so it's probably got a few years left in it before they're going to deem it unplayable for meets, you know, and so we've been patching along the way. There's a lot of other envelope issues that we have with this building. When I go through my list of here, this thing just wear and tear, treads on staircases, right now getting beginning to be dangerous. You know, we have faucets that don't shut off anymore. We have doors that don't work. You know, he came in, there's a duct tape holding the doorknob to the library. You know, it just goes on and on and on. And so, you know, the carpet in this room that we're sitting in, have you seen the ceiling in the auditorium? You know, that needs to be either painted or cleaned, or, you know, a lot of those kind of things are kind of creeping along. There's a long list of those things where it's going to add up to millions. And whether or not we should take a bond out is really something that this committee really has to tackle with the new superintendent early on, and not get to the point where all of a sudden we have to shut down certain areas of what the kids are able to do because we didn't take care of it ahead of time. So that's my plea to the committee. You know, Marty's leaving, so.
Yeah, so forget her.
Marty's, yeah, forget her.
That was one of the best when it was built, the tracks.
It really was.
A showpiece. They had individual events here and other things way back when it was first built. That was one of the jewels in the crown. But
so, Madam Chairperson, I make a motion that we instruct the new superintendent to look into the bond issue ASAP.
Well, let's talk to her before we
look at, begin to look into it. Get it on her radar.
Okay, why don't we just have that conversation with her first?
Something insist. About capital planning and improvement and stuff pops up every month.
The next meeting.
Mm-hmm. And things keep coming up and coming up and coming up.
September's meeting. Just in case, well, we might have some
life in your left for
so why don't we why don't we put that on for September's agenda so that we know it's going to be discussed?
You
could put it on in the August
agenda.
That's what I was thinking.
I'm thinking let's just deal with one thing in August.
That was kind of the charge to us because we broke ground 20 years ago. Yes, okay, we'll give you a new building, but you people need to take care of it.
Guys like him, the one in the middle.
Don't let it
take
care of it.
Take care of it. We'll build it, but take care of it.
Take care of it.
That's true.
It's time to start taking care of it.
And I think we have, but I think it's, you know.
Right, but after 20 years.
After 20 years, things start breaking, and that's what's happening.
The collaborative is next on my list. Nothing.
I got nothing.
But thank you so much for your year of service. Business manager, principal, you want to continue your thing?
So, let's pass my. The principal's report around, it's straightforward. We take commencement. We had 103 graduates. It was a wonderful evening.
Except for that train.
Except for the train that kind of parked.
The train
right
I thought was what great.
Wonderful speaker, nice job, just all wonderful. And then we will have our report where the kids are going and that kind of stuff. We usually do that in the fall. Guys puts it together in the summer and hand out in the fall so you can see where they applied, where they got accepted, and where they're all up to. Middle school had two trips in the last few weeks. The 7th grade went to Whale Watch and 8th grade went to Gettysburg. As you know, you approved it, and they both were successful trips. We did take the Science and Technology MCAS for the first time last week. And so we're waiting to see the results of those to see the changeover. As you remember, we went from biology to the Science and Technology one. So we'll be reporting on that in the fall. Today was the last day of school, and I just kind of put in the new dates for next year. Any questions on the general overview there? And then the other thing I'm passing out is Bob Lesko asked me to talk to you about there is any additional money from this year. There's the list of odds and ends that are broken in the school that we need to address. So I'll just put this around. our buffer, you know, with the shine on the floor, the batteries are reached their end. You can smell the sulfur coming out of them. There are stair treads. If you look at when you go up and down them, there are stair treads that are gotten to the point where they need to replace, become a safety hazard. The unit ventilator controls, those are the ones we're changing from hydraulic to electric, and that's kind of an ongoing thing. He wants to do another 20 units of that. Door hardware, you notice the outer doors of the building, if you've been in recently. We did all the outer doors with the new crash bars. The inner doors have not been done, and then there's other doors throughout the building that have not been done as well. So we just did the main high traffic areas, so we want to hit some of the other doors with those. He's talking about installing hand dryers to replace the paper systems, especially in student bathrooms, to reduce waste and save money in the long run. Shades on windows are starting. There are a few that are broken in several classrooms that need to be replaced just from wear and tear. And, you know, ones breaking here and there, they're very expensive. Sure. I'll be honest with you, I don't know what's wrong with the elevator in A wing. I don't know if that's replacing the carpet. I know it's functioning. I know it's operating fine, so I don't know what the repair is there. But it's a very small amount for an elevator repair, so it must be something straightforward. Must get a leaf blower for fall cleanup. Apparently there's either broken or they don't have one. The carpeted flooring, I'm not sure if that includes the library, but we met earlier this week to talk about, as you can tell, the flooring in this library.
It includes Libra, not sure if it, the other part of it.
He has a Libra? Where? Was,
just got cut off.
It got cut off, that's all.
Oh, okay. So, you know, that, and then there's a couple of offices that in the weight room got ripped up, and so we want to put a new floor partition in there as well. The lab faucets, so the faucets in our labs are just starting to leak. The seals in the faucets are not holding up. That also includes some bathroom faucets that are starting to leak and not holding up. A couple partitions that have to be replaced from wear and tear. The chair protectors are, they call fuzzy feet. They go on the floor to stop scraping up the floor, so it saves the floor in the long run. We about have 50% of the schools already been done that way. I guess the auto scrubber is that little Zamboni you see when you're here late night that they're cleaning the floor with. The vertical lift hydraulic system broke last week. And so they're talking, I guess it's reading the edge there. The batting cage, the way it's currently, these are kind of, we talk about the batting cage, that can be put on the back burner, but it's one of those things where it's each year it's kind of it's a hazard putting it, it's a very dangerous contraption to put up. And so they would like to change it over to one of the newer ones that can lift right off, that kind of thing. Football posts, unfortunately, if you at graduation saw the football posts, they still have not been redone. And the question is whether or not to just replace them with fiberglass so you never have to paint them again. But they are rusty, they are brown football posts right now. And it's, as we know, was came in very high, and here's another way of doing it. And then the overhangs, when you come into the building, the overhangs around the building, you can kind of see me out the window there, but they need to be repainted as they're starting to chip paint and get some wear. So those are some of the kind of the list of different things. If we have excess, you'd like to get some of them done as summer projects.
About $135,000 if you add it up.
Yeah.
So, Marty, I don't know what he was looking for. Did they get a boat to use excess money to use that? What was the, with not knowing the money, I don't know where they want to.
Well, right now, I don't know what the end of the year funds are. You could do one of two things. You could say, if these are prioritized in any way, to start doing these or give permission to the administration to prioritize and use X amount of dollars. Or you could wait until your summer meeting.
Which is in August.
Which is in
six
August.
Six weeks away.
Which means you're not going to be able
to take care of.
Which typically you're supposed to encumber this in June.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to take it out of this year's funds.
I understand that.
And, you know, unfortunately, we don't have that information available
Correct.
Tonight. The other Correct. Thing is, how about the OPED money? We put $100,000 there a year ago. We were hoping we'd be able to put some more there. But the other thing is, we also brought our E&D account down to a lower number at town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I hate to spend money blindly, and that's what we're doing.
I
need to do a lot of this stuff, but I don't like the idea of spending it blind.
I understand.
In a previous meeting, we had more of an idea of triaging or prioritizing what was vital for student safety and what could be a plan. Do we have any idea? I mean, it seems like I could look to see what's vital here, but do we?
I think anytime you have egress issues, that to me is vital.
Yes.
Anything along those. There are some that may be more cosmetic than, you know, than a door, but.
Floors are safe.
Well, stair treads are important.
They are.
Well, the treads are important.
You fall, so you could fall and break the leg.
Well, we could probably eliminate the batting cage and the goal post right now and do those later. Because the batting cage is a summer thing or a spring thing.
And hand dryers, too. I mean, yes, we want to save money on paper towels, but we can manage.
Right.
Yep.
Window treatments and shades, you know, that's an aesthetic thing. But building repair for the elevator in the A section, you've got to have that. You're going to want to have a leaf blower in the fall.
Correct.
Could you rent one in the fall when to get your work done? Or hire somebody
it's
to
really
come in and get the leaves?
$2,000.
Lap faucets, that to me is a must because you have to be able to turn off without having to go to the joints.
Right.
I'd also say anything to do with ventilation is a must.
But the whole thing is, we have no idea if there's $300,000 left in the budget or $100,000.
You are correct, Robert. You are correct.
And so why don't we try to earmark whatever they come up with that they think is going to be left, a third of it to the OPED, a third of it to handle these projects, and the other third just to hold in reserve.
This stuff is more important. This stuff is safety. This stuff is more important.
Well, I know, but still, you got to.
You've got to do the money.
Right. I think the only thing that's, we could spend next year's money on this, and then, you see what I'm saying. The one thing about it is getting the repairs done during the summer on some of these things, so it doesn't cause a disruption of school. So, you know, I can talk to Bob about that tomorrow, and I don't know what. So I guess we can't really get a vote from there. I understand there's no, because you don't know what that bottom line is.
Right.
You know, some of this other stuff, you mean, some of those pieces can be done by your next meeting.
If the money's not there, none of these will be done. But if there's money there that we could, like we did last year, I'm all for fixing some of these things, absolutely. But
I think what Darius is saying is that he could, July 1st, you start another fiscal year. Tap into those repairs out of the general
emergency
repairs,
the ones that require people to come in and fix, not the purchasing of equipment that we can hold off on.
Oh, I see what you're
saying. I think on a lot of these things we could hold off to the September meeting till we know what the numbers are.
Right.
To buy a leaf blower, to buy the burnisher, to buy the the things, but to replace faucets and that kind of stuff requires a plumber and that kind of stuff, and that's they try to get done some.
Well, I think that with Bill and Bob agreeing on this, I think we shouldn't really do that. So I think we should ask you to take from next year's budget, and then we can use the money when we know
we have a leftover. We can vote.
We're going to have a meeting in August.
There's nothing to prevent us once we know how much money there is.
Right.
Prevent us from putting that money in our stabilization account, turning right around and spending it.
Correct.
On these things.
Yeah. Right. I mean, we're gonna
I don't know I have. Is not.
Right. Even if you didn't approve to spend the extra, we would still end up doing the stair treads, the leaky faucets, and the elevator, no matter what, anyway.
Right. And then we can do this.
We'll take that from the general budget. That will probably be overdrawn by next year.
That's on total stuff.
But I mean, how often do they agree?
Can
I ask a question?
No.
Are you going to send any money back to the towns?
We don't know. Our business manager is not here tonight.
Yeah. But my point was, it's unlikely that if you have money, it's going to either go into your E&D account, I assume, and you have discretion on spending.
I wish you just really finish that.
Yep.
Right. So I think now...
Well, I just like to know what the number is before I spend it.
Is correct. So.
Well, absolutely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
If it all goes to the E&D account, you don't have to worry about your covering funds.
Correct.
Spending funds.
Right. No. Okay, so superintendent's report.
I don't have a written
one. The last superintendent.
Yeah, the last superintendent. I don't have a written one, but I just would like to say thank you to everybody. I've worked in this district for over 20 years. I left a couple times, but I always came back because I always found this district drawing me back. So I started out as a substitute, and I guess I got to the top position. So that's sort of a good story. But it's been a pleasure, and... just working with the guys in Deerfield, I see them. Not always a pleasure, but you know, we always got.
Ouch.
But I think we all worked, you know, whether it was school committee or town, we all work towards a common goal, which is providing the best possible education that we can for our students. So thank you.
So, Marty, thanks to Donna, this gorgeous class was ordered.
Oh, my goodness.
And it has some gorgeous printing on it. And I really wanted to give it while we're just in committee. And then I would like you to bring it with you to the other room, because there's been people coming in while we've been having our meeting to have cookies and water.
Oh, well, that's very
nice. Cookies and water.
Bread and water.
Open bar.
Bread and water.
Anyway,
I'll bring my water.
Just a little bit of a backstory. Donna Hathaway has worked very hard trying to figure out what Marty liked and called your husband, and he said absolutely nothing. She doesn't want anything. And so not only did we not get anywhere trying to put our brains together, but your husband was no help.
I'm sorry.
And he did come up with the scholarship.
Stephen and I did create a scholarship for a student pursuing education. So we gave our first award this year.
Correct.
And so I asked if, instead of parties, nothing wrong with parties, but if people wanted to contribute to the scholarship, they could.
So we wanted to give you this, and we also wanted to give you these. They've been in air conditioning all day, so they are now yours. And just so everyone knows, I have a card that I am going to just open up and leave over there, so you can just put a little note in for Marty, and we're going to, I'd like a motion to...
Move to adjourn.
Adjourn. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
And so we're just going to move over and just have some conversation.
Oh.
Yeah. Thank you. That was it.
Thank you. That was very nice.
Look at that.